Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all of the roses falling. Tis you must go and I must bide. But come ye back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. Tis I'll be there in the sunshine or in the shadow. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you.
If you could all rise for a moment of silence, please. Thank you. Please be seated. Good morning, everyone. Before I call this meeting to order, I think we're going to have a little tribute of our matriarch, the architect of our city, who passed away this weekend. So I beg your indulgence before we start our budget meeting, and then we will lead into our council meeting, if I may. So this truly is the end of an era. It's been a very hard week for me personally, and of course for the city of Mississauga and our residents. We had to say goodbye to a woman who gave so much of her life to our city, to our community, and even after her retirement, she was a constant presence out at events, at banquets, and parades, and celebrations throughout Mississauga. And I think it's fair to say that we thought she would be here forever, like the Queen. And in a way she is, because she will live on forever in our hearts. We will carry Hazel with us forever. Whether it's around this council table and all of us can hear her voice ringing in our ears, telling us to always remember to do your homework in that raspy voice. Whether we're at budget committee, GC, council, governance, planning meetings, late nights preparing. We're probably the most best prepared council as a result of those words. And for our residents, many of whom were attracted to live here because of her policies of certainty, stability, and growth that she fostered during her time as mayor. She sat in this very chair for 36 years and made decisions here that formed the foundation of the city that we know and love today. I like to say that many of us chose Mississauga as the place to live, to work, to invest in, to raise our children in, because of her stewardship, because she built the city in her vision. And her mark on this city is undeniable, and it's indelible. You see Hazel McCallion all around us, whether it's the Hazel McCallion Central Library, the Hazel McCallion Wing at Sheridan College, the Hazel McCallion Building at UTM, or at Trillium Health Partners. And now, of course, our LRT line will be named the Hazel McCallion LRT. And I sit here knowing that I carry the mantle of responsibility and of her trust as her successor. And I will always endeavor to meet that high standard of expectation she set for all of us, but for herself as well. She set an example in Mississauga and showed us that there was room at the table for women, not only to participate, but to lead. She shattered every glass ceiling, every barrier imaginable, starting her career as a female hockey player in Montreal, and came to Toronto in a business career and was the general manager of the very power plant that she later took down as mayor of this city. She was formidable. I know that as a councillor for Ward 5 for one term, I was shaking in my boots as I was called down to her office. I feel like I was being summoned to the principal's office in elementary school. She had many maxims, and one that we all remember other than do your homework, quality of life second to none. But the other one I think that stays with me is think like a man, act like a lady, and work like a dog. And we all know she did that. But she opened so many doors for us and made Mississauga a progressive paragon when it came to female representation and leadership roles. Half my commissioners are women. Our acting city manager is a woman. Our fire chief is a woman. Our former police chief is a woman. The person who leads our hospitals, the CEO, is a woman. Half our council is women. She opened the doors to many of us. It was a meritocracy here at the city. As a woman, you knew if you did your homework, you could be successful and succeed. And today, that door is open to everyone. Everyone today has an equal opportunity of success in Mississauga because of the standard that Hazel McCallion put in place. And that legacy continues to this day. I'm comforted now that Hazel has been joined her with her beloved husband, Sam, and they're now both at peace. And may she rest in peace. I want to thank you for this opportunity to share some of my memories and thoughts. And now I'd like to open it up to any of my counselors who would like to share some memories as well. Leading us off will be Councillor Matt Mahoney. Matt, over to you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. And it's certainly difficult to follow you and I'm not going to lie, it's difficult to speak to this, but I felt it was important to do so. It might surprise many that I first met Hazel in 1978. My dad and Hazel were both elected in the same year. Hazel is mayor, and my dad is a councillor for Ward 8. So I don't specifically have a memory of that day, but I do remember an iconic photo of my brother given the honour of presenting Hazel with flowers. When she was given the chain of office and swore in, and that photo was in the front page of the Mississauga News. So my brother used to joke that he was more famous than Hazel for at least one day. You know, Hazel had indicated at the time that she really might have only been interested in running for one or two terms. So I believe it was 1986 or 87 when my dad approached her and said, you know, if she was considering retirement, because he'd been approached by the province to perhaps run provincially with the Liberals. And Hazel, in her way, looked at him straight in the eyes and said, you know, Steve, they need good people at the province, too. So off he went and packed his boxes, and he was gone. But this opened up, you know, an opportunity for my mom and Hazel to become very close and very good friends when my mom ran for council. And they formed a very strong bond, along with Councillor Sato and Councillor Mullen and Councillor Prentice back in the day. And as you've said, Madam Mayor, breaking glass ceilings and smashing them actually was certainly impressive and inspirational. One of the things that Hazel always said to me was one of her favorite places to visit was the Mahoney Family Cottage, and she enjoyed going up there. And you know, some funny stories of her and my mom sitting in the hot tub with my mom with a rum and coke in hand and Hazel with a sherry and sitting under the stars and, you know, for hours and just chatting and reminiscing, not talking about work, but just talking about family and grandkids and those types of things. And my dad tells a story of them being out fishing, and as everybody knows, Hazel loved fishing. And, you know, the skies opened up one day and the rain came down in buckets, and you know, my dad said, "Well, Hazel, it's really raining. We should head in." And she said, "Well, I'm just going to be sitting in the hot tub with Katie getting wet. So what's the difference? Let's stay out." So they stayed out for a couple of hours, you know, and I don't know if they caught anything. But one of the other interesting, and everybody can get a visual of this, that Hazel loved, we have a four-wheeler quad at the cottage. We had two family black labs, Boomer and Duke, and everybody knows how much Hazel liked dogs. So you can picture Hazel squeezing my dad, putting a helmet on the back of the quad as they would run the cottage road, watching the dogs jump through the woods and the forest with Hazel with a big smile on her face, and really enjoyed that. So great memories for Hazel and for my parents, who obviously were very, very close. As everybody around this table can appreciate, you don't always get along in politics. And my dad would always say, and Hazel would always say, it's not personal, it's politics. And, you know, these are things that when you work so closely together for so many years that you really need to, you know, to understand. It's not personal, it's politics. And the friendship and bond that they formed with my parents was great. As it comes to me, she was always very, very supportive of me. Even when I was going to run, she had expressed such joy and confidence in me, which, as I'm sure everybody can appreciate, was extremely humbling. So I certainly do want to thank Hazel for her service to the city of Mississauga, but also want to thank her for the friendship specifically to my parents over the years, and that special bond that she formed, especially with my mom, which is something that she will never forget. Unfortunately, they're out of town and can't be here, but I certainly did want to speak on their behalf. And on behalf of my whole family, my parents, my wife, my kids, I do want to thank Hazel for everything she's done for the city and for her friendship. And, you know, people always say when they pass that, you know, they'll never be forgotten. And I think, Madam Mayor, as you just indicated, we've named half the city after her, so at every corner we'll certainly see her name. So thank you very much. And again, thank you to Hazel. And on behalf of the Mahoneys, our sincere condolences to the McCallion family. Thank you.
Well put, Councillor Mahoney. Thank you very much for that profound tribute. And now to Councillor Brad Butt.
Thank you very much, Madam Mayor. Good morning, everyone, and thank you in the audience for people joining us today for this very special tribute. I first met Hazel when I was 10 years old, and similar to Councillor Mahoney, that was when she was sworn in as the councillor for Streetsville. At the time, there was a ward that was strictly Streetsville, and my father was sworn in as a councillor for the Applewood Lakeview area at the time. And so I was 10 years old. That's when I met her for the first time. And as they say, even then, she was a larger than life figure, even though we were basically the same height. I've probably known Hazel the longest. I'm 55, so that's 45 years that I've known and had a friendship with Hazel. You know, she created the Mayor's Youth Advisory Committee in 1982, when most politicians didn't care what young people were thinking or wanted to be involved in their community. I joined in that inaugural meeting, I'll never forget, in January. It was a snowstorm in the old City Hall, and there was Hazel. Running in with about 12 or 15 of us around the table to get that initiative off and running. I went on to become the chair of the Mayor's Youth Advisory Committee for 2 years, which started my interest in politics, running for the first time for council at the age of 21. I still don't forgive Nando Yanika for beating me, despite her encouragement, and ruining my chances to serve with her on council. She created the Citizens Task Force on the Future of Mississauga in 2000. I was honored to co-chair that committee, which recommended Mississauga be a standalone city from the Region Appeal. And here we are, 23 years later, still having that conversation. Well, maybe Hazel's dream will finally come true. My real political interaction really came after I was elected as the Member of Parliament for Mississauga-Streetsville. This is when I learned, and Mayor Crombie and Councillor Parrish, I'm sure, will back me up, conversations with Mayor McCallion that were always one-sided. She talked and you listened, and you got voluntold what to do. Today, I'm actually wearing my House of Commons tie in her honor, always advocating for the best interests of her city and reminding you if you were doing it wrong. I once asked her why she was so successful in politics, and I know the mayor mentioned this, and she quipped to me, "Think like a man, act like a woman, work like a dog." During the debates about smoking in restaurants, she once said, and I quote, "A smoking section of a restaurant is like a peeing section in a pool." I will always remember that remarkable insight. So I want to close with a little story. When I was an MP and I was speaking to the Conservative Caucus in Ottawa, we had a presentation from the Minister of Canadian Heritage on the commemorations for the 200th anniversary of the War of 1812. And the government announced that they were going to rename some of the buildings in the National Capital Region for significant figures from that war, and they were asking for suggestions. I got up in the caucus meeting and said that I thought we should rename one of the buildings after Mississauga Mayor Hazel McCallion, because as everybody knows, she fought in the War of 1812. I have never seen Prime Minister Harper laugh so hard in my entire life when I mentioned that to her. And Hazel loved those stories, and she loved to laugh. I told her that story a few years ago so that she didn't hear it from somebody else, and I got a great laugh from her. She thought it was great. And then she asked, "How did Harper take it?" Which is always what she would be worried about, is what the Prime Minister or the Premier would be thinking. Hazel McCallion has had a profound impact on my life and my interest in public service, and I know many others feel the same. Just remember, this all started in the little village of Streetsville that elected her to the local planning board, and she never looked back. We are all so grateful for her close to five decades of public service, her love of her city and her residents, and for reminding all of us to do our homework. Thank you, Hazel. We love you. May God continue to bless you. Rest in peace.
Oh, very moving, Brad. Thank you so much. Thank you for your memories. To Councillor Chris Fonseca, please.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Good morning, everyone. I'd first like to extend my deepest condolences to the McCallion family and all loved ones of Hazel. I first met Hazel, like many of us, out in the community in Mississauga, at a sport youth event in a park, many years actually before I was elected to council. And right from that very first experience with Hazel, it was clear why she had earned the name Hurricane Hazel, and more importantly, the People's Mayor. She arrived on her own with incredible energy and enthusiasm, walking, or should I say blazing, right into the crowd of all of us there, and started talking to everyone with purpose, with passion, and compassion. We were in a park, as I mentioned, and she took the time with everyone, connecting, taking photos, and she would always find time, no matter who came up to her, to take photos with people. Listening, learning, laughing with all of us in that afternoon event. As I was one of the youth volunteers, she had come up to me when she arrived. She stuck out her hand. She was looking me straight in the eye, but with a huge smile on her face. And I told her my name. An hour after the event and her being there, and meeting and shaking the hands of hundreds of people, going through the formal, or should I say really informal, presentation with that hop, skip, and a jump, not even choosing to hop onto the stage, but just be in amongst everyone there. When she was leaving, she did take the time to come up with each one of us youth leaders, recognizing all of us by name, and putting us to the task and challenging us, of course, to continue to do our homework in the community. Hazel always found a way to connect with people. Through these connections, she inspired, encouraged, and most importantly for me, empowered others to find a way in their own right, within themselves, to give back to the community, to give back to her beloved, to our beloved city of Mississauga, and really to become leaders in our own right, no matter what path we may choose. I'm extremely grateful that I could call on Hazel at any time, at any hour, as a mentor, as a friend, and honored that I was able to serve with Hazel from 2010 to 2014 on City of Mississauga and Region of Peel Council. You know, she always led before I got onto council, and then after, she always led with, how's the family? How's Peter? How are the boys? What are they doing in their sport? What are they doing in education? She showed so much interest in youth and in family. She inspired and encouraged me to run, and without hesitation, reminded me once I was elected that I would always be able to find the path forward out in the community. Actively continue to stay involved in the community. She would say, you know, Chris, never forget that you were a strong voice in the community before you got elected. You have to continue to do that. Don't hesitate to stand up, stand with, stand for community and for the city of Mississauga. Two tests that I think I passed somewhat successfully in the early, very nerve-wracking days of serving with Hazel on council. One early morning at City Hall here, she arrived unannounced, just came right through my door, my office door, and she did smile. She poked her head in and smiled. It was around 7 a.m., and council was yet to start a few hours later. And there was an item on the agenda for Ward 3, and of course, she tested me to see if I had done my homework by asking me so many questions. You know, she would always say, Chris, don't sweat the small stuff, but then proceed to ask all of these nerve-wracking questions. Have you done your homework? What's the policy, Chris? Focus in on the policy. Another test, she was an early riser, and she would call me pretty regularly on Saturday or Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. to test me to see if I was awake. But I had a trick, a test of my own. I, too, am a very early riser. So, it was probably the only time that I ever heard her pause when one morning she did call me in the early days at 6 a.m. on a Sunday morning, and I answered the phone. And she said to me and challenged me, Chris, next week we need to have a breakfast meeting, and we're going to do it at 6 a.m. And I responded with, of course, Hazel, but can we make it 5:30? I will close with where I began, with community. Thank you, Hazel, for being that incredible force of nature. Yes, sometimes bumpy roads. Yes, sometimes very celebratory roads. But you were a guiding light that always put community and service to and for our great city of Mississauga first. While you spent 36 years calling this incredible chamber your home as mayor, challenging and supporting council, the leadership team, the city staff in the city of Mississauga to do our homework, to consider what is the policy and to welcome Mississauga residents and the world into these chambers, looking challenges straight in the eye and creating opportunities and making decisions right here in these chambers, always with purpose of making Mississauga a great place to live and work and play. Your legacy also lies out there in the community, where you blazed a trail by living, laughing, learning, and loving and connecting with people in Mississauga, Ontario, Canada, around the world, and always finding ways to shine a light on our great city of Mississauga. Rest in peace, Hazel.
Thank you, Chris. That was very moving. Beautiful. And to Councillor Dasko.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. And truly a day that I think most people didn't fully appreciate what actually come to us, because she was one of these larger than life figures that that you just expected to live on forever. And I think each and every person in the city can talk of a story of how she's affected them and you know, different periods of time over the years. She's definitely left impressions on many. And I know I first crossed paths with her as a young boy. We were doing my Cub Scout group and organized a tour of the old City Hall and through the mayor's office, and that's where I first came across Madam Mayor, and it definitely left an impression upon me. And I know that she had done that with hundreds throughout the years. I really had the opportunity and the good fortune to speak with her often, especially over the past few years, or several years, and we always talked about the importance of understanding where you've been so you know where you're going. And that's always been an interesting part of whenever she spoke, she'd always put things in context and she'd give you some of the different layers of why decisions became to be what they were and how things evolved. And I do recall this was last year. I had had something on my mind I wanted to go and ask her about, and we're getting into kind of the nicer weather. And some might recall, if they've been up to her house, it was to go around the side and she'd see you in the backyard. And this was especially during COVID times. And so came to the house, walked around the back, and I thought, what is she doing? She was hunched over. And as I said to her, you know, good morning, she popped her head up and she had a handful of dandelions in her hand. And this was literally at 100 years of age, she was pulling dandelions from the grass. And then I said, well, again, like, are you still doing all of your gardening yourself? She said, you're darn right I am. And she was just a force. I guess one of the things that she had said during that time is she said, you know, I've been retired for a while now, and like some other people, I could have moved away and I could have done my own thing by now somewhere else. But Mississauga is home. And this is just such a true thing, especially if you've been in her home. What people have given her over the years, she truly never threw anything out. It was chock full of all kinds of different artifacts, and especially when they were setting up at Aaron Mills Town Center couple of years, when they had the history of Hazel there, and they were just going and mining her house for all of these great artifacts. And just one other that I'd like to share with her was this past September was pretty incredible. So at 101 years old, there is Paint the Town Red, which she always participated in, and she listened to actually sitting in a car and doing the parade in that. But then there was the Southside Shuffle, and this was the Mardi Gras parade that happened from here, Ontario, all the way out to Stavebank. Now, that's a good stretch of road for somebody at 101. And I had the good fortune to walk the parade with her, and I recall doing that. At the end of it all, I was asking somebody if we could get a chair for her to sit down because it was unseasonably warm. And she turned to me and she said, "No, no, I don't need a chair. I want to go for a beer." And off she went, and she went for her beer. And, you know, truly with Hazel, she's one that asked a lot of people, but it was always for the good of people, and it was for the good of the city. And most certainly am going to miss her. I think everybody will. And may God rest her. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. And to Councillor Kovac, please.
And thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll just say, as a kid growing up in the 1980s in the Croatian-Canadian community, going to church every Sunday, picnics we had regularly, especially in the summertime, for major saint days, Hazel McCallion was always there, to the point, as a small child, I actually thought she was Croatian. And as our ethno-cultural community was our homeland, experiencing conflict overseas, not too dissimilar to what Ukraine is currently going through, and our people struggled for independence, Hazel was there as a very early supporter. And that meant, and continues to this day to mean a great deal to members of the Croatian community. And she would say, of course, Canada first. You're Canadian first, but do not ever forget your roots, for they shape who you are and who and what you will become. And it's incredibly meaningful, as it is and as it has been, to watch her interact with other members within Mississauga's very rich multicultural environment. Carisauga, she really was the linchpin keeping that event together, supporting all of those groups. And I thought the other day when, you know, it was very somber, a Sunday, if I'm to tell a story, which one might it be of Hazel McCallion? Not that I have too many. One would be when I first went for breakfast with her soon after having joined council. Another time was I think, the very first Raptors 905 game, and it was in the VIP area. Somehow I was converging with her at the same time. Masai Ujiri put his hand on my shoulder, perhaps sensing a fellow lanky individual who walked in a similar kind of way to himself. And Hazel wanted to introduce me to Larry Tannenbaum. Now, that's a funny story. But what I want to tell you is the very first time I went for breakfast with her. It was at Family Orchard Restaurant. I was to arrive for 8 o'clock. And I wanted to be early, so I got there by about 7:45. She was there at 7:15, and I heard later it was because she hadn't seen the manager in a little while, and she knew all the staff. There was no bowing down to her. Like, they respected her very, very much so, but there was no intimidation factor. So I saw that, and I was not fully aware of how, you know, people might you know, be with her. But when we finally sat down, I did feel her, she was serious throughout the entire breakfast, which was about 2 hours. I almost felt like she was staring right into my eyes, observing me, and asked me lots of questions. I felt like it was a job interview, and wanted to know my background. I told her English literature was what I had majored in at U of T, and she said, "Okay, good, good. Keep in mind, John, that there's gonna be a lot of reports, engineering reports, corporate reports. If you enjoy reading, that's good. One aspect of the job that is completely lost on the community," I'm paraphrasing when I say this, "the amount of reading that members of council are required to do. It really is a hidden aspect to the job that is crucial." She then, at one point, not gossiped, I didn't get this sense at all, but gave me a little bit of a rundown on who I would be working with, but it was their strengths. And she had a positive thing to say about everybody, even persons who I might have thought were formerly her adversaries. If anything, she was even more positive with those, having respect for them and their hard work and their abilities. We argued a little bit on religion. That was a fun thing. I, a Catholic, her Protestant, but we found common ground as two Christians. And when she left, I was worried, you know, what she might have thought of me. And there was a person who was her aide and confidant who was there and sat quietly throughout the entire meeting, later told me, "John, rest assured," she said, "he seems like a good young man, honest, a thinker. I think he'll do well." And I'll just say, as a member of the Canadian Croatian community, as a member of council, as a citizen of Mississauga, I too am in mourning. She will never be forgotten. She is our matriarch, forever will be. And my condolences to her family. Thank you.
Really well said, John. Thank you. And to Martin Reed.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. My condolences to the McCallion family. And I'm just reflecting on Hazel, and two words come to mind: significance and leadership. And I look back on my first interaction with Mayor Hazel at the time in 1999 when I was working at the dam, and there's this big buzz in our, you know, we're doing a silent auction, and the mayor's coming, and we're the small upstart nonprofit. So to have someone that important there was a significant moment. And I didn't even know who she was at the time, and I was close enough to be in a picture with her, and I used that picture in my campaign to say 25 years later I knew her. There's a quote that I always go by, and I think of Hazel with this, is that never underestimate the significance of the insignificant. And for Hazel on that day, that could have been her fourth, fifth meeting. That could have been the third meeting of the evening. She could have been on her way home and just thought, oh yeah, I forgot, I need to do this favor for Bill Crawford, and I'll show up at the dam and just show my face quickly. For her, it could have been just another thing in that day, because she just likes to be there. She likes young people. She'll just, you know, lend her presence to that. But for us, it was so significant. It was so powerful to have her presence there, and I remember that. And I see that all of us as members of council and Mayor Crombie, we all make it a point to get to events, as insignificant as it may be in our day, it's significant to them, and we take the time. And it has a powerful impact, and we see that that was a legacy that she left, the significant piece. The second thing I think of with Hazel is that mantle of leadership. That leadership is a powerful thing, because in Mississauga, we take it for granted that there are so many women in leadership. We look at this table, and we're just here. Smart, strong, gifted, talented, no questions asked. You think of a female mayor, we got one. We've had one. We have one again. That is something that we just see here, but we forget the fact that that wasn't always the case, and she fought for that. And I'm reflecting on that as we're in Black History Month right now, that there is a whole generation of students that have not seen a Black counselor. And the same way that a child in 30 years ago might not have seen a female in leadership, they look at me and say, I could probably do that because I see him up there. A little girl would have said that 30 years ago. I could do that because I see her up there. So that mantle leadership that she carried that makes it easy for a woman to be in leadership in Mississauga is something that I carry as a Black man in leadership here, to say, I see her blueprint, and this is something that is possible for a student now. So thank you, Hazel, for that.
Thank you, Martin. That was very moving as well. I'm going to break protocol, because I can, and ask if any of the commissioners would like to share a memory, or there's a few people in the gallery who have known Hazel longer than many of us, so I will give you 3 minutes, few of you, maybe three or four of you, If we can have public, I see a few of you who I think want to say something. Any of the commissioners want to share a memory? I'm going to let you light up the board as well, and I'll acknowledge you, and if not, okay, starting with Jeff Wright.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and I would just say my experience working with the former Mayor McCallion, I had the opportunity to work with her from 2007 up to her retirement in 2014. And my experience is that she was always very welcoming to new staff coming into the organization, and at the time I had relocated from Nova Scotia, so I have fond memories of her calling me into her office, spending some time with me, talking about my transition to Mississauga, and kind of giving me her overview of her vision for transportation at the time, and which transcended into significant support for the building and the development of transit in Mississauga, where we are today. And I think that's quite evident in terms of, her, as you mentioned, Madam Mayor, the Hazel McCallion line will be sort of that legacy that she's left behind for Mississauga. But I would always, I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge her support of staff and the organization over her years. And that's something that I think the staff who had the privilege of working with Hazel would certainly remember, is that she was always a big supporter of staff. And I remember seeing Hazel McCallion when she would walk into a transit facility or a works yard, that she would always be very complimentary of the staff working in that area. So that's something that I think we will cherish is her really supporting the staff and the organization and giving credit where credit was due. So thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Any of the other commissioners? Okay. Looking at some folks in the audience, anyone want to share a memory? I'm looking at the two of you. No? Okay. We'll call it closed then. Thank you very much for your memories. Let me just say, Chris, I really appreciated what you said about that 5:30 a.m. breakfast. I think all of us thought Hazel never slept a wink. Honest to God, I know many of the staff would receive emails well into the night. We weren't even sure Hazel could use email. Believe me, she would email people the night because she didn't sleep, and how would it be drinking her tea, not her coffee, and by 6 a.m. was ready to make phone calls. And not only you, Councillor Fonseca, but prime ministers and premiers and ministers, to tell them what she thought and to get on it and where were they on her priorities. So we all knew that about her. We always knew where Hazel McCallion stood on every issue. She didn't make it a secret. So to this diminutive dynamo with the boundless energy, that force of nature that we all know as Hurricane Hazel, thank you. On behalf of the residents of Mississauga and our council and team here, we're going to miss you. You will be forever in our hearts. Please rest in peace. Thank you.